Atari 2600. This 8-bit beast was an intro to console gaming for many over the decades, but you know what I think it really needs? How about a basic compiler that is basic? How about a sprite editor that maxed out at 2 colors? And what if it had jingle bells? Yes, that's much better. We now have a substandard microcomputer with a keyboard that makes me feel gross to use. The CompuMate by Spectra Video was released in early 1983 and was designed as a tool to whet your appetite in 8-bit computing. Today, my goal is to demonstrate said wetting and show how much of it will actually occur throughout usage, so you don't have to. If you're German, it was known as the Universum Heimcomputer. If you're from Brazil, there were 2 clones of the system, one called the Dactar Comp by Milmar Electronics, with the other simply called the CompuGame. A big RGO shout-out goes to viewer Adam, who pointed me in the direction of a boxed online listing through the second-hand store, Cash Converters. It was situated in a different state to where I live, so as a mini review within a review, I'll first quickly show you how well it was packaged in case you were considering buying from Cashies online yourself. And, as you can see, they did a decent enough job. The package size was well suited to that of the box, although they did use an abundance of packing peanuts, a particular pet hate of several YouTubers. Still, while annoying, they did ensure the safe arrival of the CompuMate. Now if I were to complain, it would be about the sales sticker that was too great at its job. I was impatient and didn't use something like a hairdryer to remove it, and that impatience cost me a piece of printed cardboard. Oh well. So then, who was Spectra Video? Originally known as Spectra Vision, changing their name in 1982 because there was a hotel TV system of the same name. Initially, they were a distribution house. Originally selling games for a handful of 8-bit systems, their first breakout hit was the budget ergonomic joystick, the QuickShot. At the Winter CES in early 1983, they took the leap into computing. They announced their first computer, the SV318, but also the star of this video, the CompuMate. Manufactured as one whole connected device, the CompuMate consists of a membrane keyboard and a cartridge. There is even a handy slot built into the keyboard to hold the cartridge when it's not in use. I love how self-sufficient 80s tech was. Otherwise, a cable connects those 2 components, while 2 more cables protrude from the cartridge, which each plug into a joystick port on the 2600. The CompuMate utilizes the 6507 CPU from the 2600 as the brains for the operation, while adding an extra 2K of RAM and 16K of ROM. This allows 10 lines of 12 characters, or 40 by 40 pixels, and 10 colors. The only input-output are 2 3.5mm jacks on the side to connect to a cassette interface, one for loading, the other for saving. Hooking up the CompuMate is a trivial matter. The cartridge goes into the cartridge slot, and both cables plug into the joystick ports, although this does mean that there is no pass-through for a joystick while the CompuMate is plugged in. If you own a Heavy Sixer, the keyboard is designed to sit right on top of the console. I only owned the Junior model, so for me, the keyboard will sit out front, but that's okay. Before I show you the programs, I need to mention the video capturing situation. My Elgato Game Capture HD didn't agree with the CompuMate's way of outputting video, and while it appears fine on screen, certain horizontal lines of text don't record properly. So I ran out and bought a cheapo composite to HDMI converter. While this fixed the line rendering issue, the sound then recorded super quietly, or not at all. Maybe I went a little too cheapo. So, it's a bit of a lose-lose. I used one or the other depending on what I'm recording. The sound isn't that important in some modes, for instance, so you may see a bit of variance in quality of the recording. But with that out of the way, let's switch it on. The CompuMate first boots into the text screen. An OK will signify that everything is, in fact, OK, and a rendition of Twinkle Twinkle Little Star will play to lull you to sleep. This is the screen where we can program. But since I find that the most interesting portion of this device, I'll save that until last. Let's start with Magic Easel, the graphics and animation software. To start that, we need to navigate to the graphics screen. This is accomplished by holding down function and pressing this key. Magic Easel will then launch, And let me just preface this by pointing out how misleading some of the advertisements were. They claim you can play as Picasso. But look at this. Look how many colours there are. I counted 3 colours for Snoopy, including the background, and 5 here. While the CompuMate can display a total of 10 colours, including black and white, it can only show 2 of those at a time, one for the pixels you're drawing and one for the background. On top of that, you can store 6 images in RAM at a time, but these all must conform to that same two-tone colour scheme. If you change it on one image, it will change it for all. Disappointing colours aside, there are 2 illustrations built in to show the machine's full potential. There's an endearing snow scene with a snowman. Or the world! Tasmania has reattached itself to the mainland. It's an 8-bit miracle. Since there is no joystick support, drawing is achieved by arrow keys. Lots of fun. At least there are diagonal keys, but it makes you wonder if a joystick would be more efficient or not. Drawing is as slow and painful as you'd expect. Using the J or K keys, you can switch between drawing and erasing. There's no mode to just move the cursor without either happening, however, so you'll need to be sure you don't accidentally erase or draw when moving the cursor to somewhere else on the screen. Up to 6 works of art can be stored at once in RAM. You can then animate them, changing how fast they show by using the tempo key. And that's it for Magic Easel. It's very simplistic. Let's function key over to the music screen. Like with Magic Easel, there are samples available. Along with Twinkle Twinkle Little Star, which you've already heard, there's also cheerful renditions of Long Long Ago, Jingle Bells, and My Bonnie. This program seems okay on paper, but I did experience a few issues. Now this might be user error, who knows, but for one, I couldn't get the 2 sound types to work. According to the manual, you can switch between piano and organ sounds, although they sounded the same to me. There is also support for 2 channels of audio at the same time, but again, when I switched to the second channel, the software wouldn't accept any notes. With that aside though, the software should allow you to create songs in dual channel while controlling the duration that each note plays and if it's either an organ or piano sound. You can also determine factors such as the pitch and tempo. There's a decent editing function too. You can go back and change and edit notes in a non-linear fashion, which can't be said for the programming portion, but we'll get to that. On paper, the Music Composer is a reasonably robust piece of software, although it is hard to control. With there being no GUI or mouse support, everything is achieved by a slew of keyboard shortcuts, making it difficult to learn. To be honest, I was a bit put off and didn't really have much inclination to sit around and create a song anyway. So let's head back to the text screen. Yes, the bit I enjoyed the most, basic programming. The text screen does show the true limitations of the hardware, however. 12 characters per line is a pain, but the included memory only allows for 100 lines of code overall. It can create programs, sure, but they'll be small ones. There's no functionality to use your sprites or music either. All programs are purely text-based. Another drawback is the missing ability to edit previous lines of code. You can edit the line you're currently writing, but once you hit that enter key, you've committed. So you better pay attention and write it correctly first up, or you're in for a painful bout of retyping. Imagine screwing up line 99. Ugh. Typing is slow too. The memory and keyboard isn't great, but what really annoyed me were the quick function keys. For example, hitting the P key will type PRT, which of course means print. That's all fine and good, but the first time you press P on a new line of code, PRT will be typed whether you want it or not. You'll have to delete it if you wish to type the letter P, and even that's not so straightforward. There's no dedicated backspace key. Instead, shift space will do the job, but it's a minor inconvenience on top of another minor inconvenience. Otherwise, there is a slew of basic commands built in, which is nice, but the manual seems to shortchange this. Only a handful are mentioned, and since you can't edit lines of code, experimentation would have been tough. I'm surprised there isn't even a simple reference guide for each function. Users would have been on their own. In fact, it doesn't even tell you how to load games from a cassette, which is a major oversight. I had to Google it. Not something users would have had the privilege of doing in 1983. In the present day, using a cassette drive is not necessary. I don't own one anyway. But anything that outputs sound through a 3.5mm jack will suffice. I used my smartphone, since it's still a model that has a headphone jack, and downloaded a handful of games in MP3 format. As you can imagine, there are not many programs out there for such a computer, being the small footnote in history it is. But a chap named Graham Percy has shared several of his creations, so I don't have to program anything myself. To load these, an auxiliary cable is connected between the headphone jack of the phone and the input jack labeled ear on the CompuMate. In the text screen, hit Function J for the load command and then press Enter. The screen will go a bit funny, but give it a few seconds of leeway before playing the MP3 file at full volume on your phone. The screen will change to indicate it's receiving data, and once it's done, hit Function R, Run, to start the program. Quest A is a notable example by Mr. Percy, as it's a text adventure that uses the full 100 lines it's entitled to. While simplistic and short, it's a great example of the machine truly running basic, even if it is so limited. On the opposite end, you can, of course, save your program, but also any images or songs you create. This is done much the same way, except using the save command and the output labeled mic. I don't have a cable with the correct ring layout on hand to demonstrate this, but I'm sure you get the gist. You would use some sort of recording app on your phone, or maybe something like Audacity if you were recording to a computer. There was never any third-party software released, but it was stated in an October 1983 issue of Popular Science that 12 educational programs are going to be sold on cassette for $10 each. Well, CompuMate users instead got two, PictureMate and SongMate, both released in 1983. Let's start with PictureMate. Come to visit this exciting animal's world. Many friendly animals are waiting to make friend with you. Yes, from what I can tell, it's some sort of animal guessing game. I can't find any rips of the tape online though, not even any footage of it on YouTube, so your guess is as good as mine. It's the same situation for SongMate. Enjoy music with SongMate, trademark, compose a little song for fun. I couldn't even tell you what that's about. Information is sparse, as both releases seem quite rare. So, in the scheme of things, how did the CompuMate do? Well, naturally, I couldn't find any sales numbers, but it does seem common and may as well had its place in the market even though it was so simplistic. The restrictions are harsh, but maybe it was effective as an opener to the world of computing. The CompuMate sold for $80 in 1983. As a comparison, the venerable Commodore 64 sold at an introductory price of $595 just a year before. The C64 was infinitely better, of course, but I can see that at just $80, the CompuMate may well have had been an easy purchase to get a taster of 8-bit computing if you already owned a 2600. An argument could be made that it existed just to get you to buy Spectra Video's own SV318 once you depleted all that CompuMate had to offer. Heck, they even directly pointed out at the end of the manual, saying, "They'll be waiting with the SV318 once you're ready to, quote, step up." Well, it seems that not many people did, as Spectra Video wasn't one for this world. They squeezed out a few more computers in the mid-80s, but by 1985 they were in a bad financial state, allegedly because of bad distribution and poor visibility in stores. A decision was made to wrap up US operations by their major shareholder, Bontwell Holding, and eventually the brand was phased out completely. But for what it's worth, Spectra Video should be commended for actually releasing the CompuMate. An 8-bit computer is a decently major feat on the 2600, featureless or not. There were several similar devices planned for the 2600, but this is the only one that ever actually came to fruition. Such unreleased devices include the Unitronix Expander, the NTEX Piggyback, and even one from Atari themselves called My First Computer. So props to Spectra Video for at least releasing the CompuMate. The closest thing you can buy is a 2600 cartridge called Basic Programming, although this is more of an instructional cartridge and doesn't actually let you write programs. If you would like to buy a CompuMate, be prepared to shell out the going price of approximately $150 US. They were once considered rare, but the story goes that a bunch were discovered in a Venezuelan warehouse around 2011. So if you look them up on eBay today, that's where all the listings are based. But that's all I have for you today about the Spectra Video CompuMate. I hope you found it interesting, and I'll catch you in the next video.